So for example, if you look at imagine the triangle in R3, imagine the triangle that passes through E1, E2, and E3. Okay, that imagine that triangle. So here I am just drawing the XY plane part. Okay, somewhere here I am just drawing. This is the XY plane part I am drawing. But okay, there is one more like just on the top of the this thing, and you have a triangle that passes through E1, E2, and E3. That is the triangle. Triangle, rather I should say triangular plate, the convex hull of E1, E2, E3. Okay. Now, once you imagine that, and imagine the plane that passes through, that is, so the plane x plus y equal to 1. So if I take x plus y equal to 1, this is the plane, okay, just standing up. Okay, that would be the plane that will be standing up. And you have the triangle as if like, if I do it like this, the triangle will be on this side. And the plane will be straight, standing up straight. Okay, so that plane is supporting this set. Supporting at what point? Now supporting at any point of this line segment joining E1 and E2, it is supporting. And is it supporting positively or negatively? Now look, for example, what do I have? I have C transpose x plus y equal to 1. So that is the plane XYZ. Okay, so there is one more point of the set, not only one more point, there are many points. So take any point, for example, I put 001. If I put 001, what do I get? Now, if I put 001, the product I am getting is 0. So it is keeping the whole set, this convex hull, this one. So the in that case, this convex hull S is in H minus. That is, this contains all the points. So this is a subset of the points X such that C transpose X less than equal to 1. So it supports that set negatively at any of these points. These points means points, any of the points on the line segment joining E1 and E2. Okay, that's fine, no problem. Can you imagine one hyperplane that supports S positively at E3? Okay. Now, okay, but here do not look at the drawing. You imagine yourself XY plane as if our tabletop, and then Z axis is standing. And at that, I am looking for a hyperplane equation kind of a thing, so that everything will satisfy greater than equal to. In that case, I will be taking, for example, 0, 0, minus 1, x, y, z equal to minus 1. This will pass through E3. Okay, if you let it pass through E3, this will be satisfied. And anything below E3, okay? So if I take, for example, 100, so that will be a lesser negative. That basically means it will be greater than minus 1. So this is that plane. This is that answer. Okay. 4.4, what is a fact? Now, if I have two hyperplanes supporting a set at a point W positively, and I take a convex combination of them, that will also give me a supporting hyperplane through W and positively supporting the set positively. And therefore, like you are allowed to take any convex combination. Therefore, if I have two linearly independent hyperplanes supporting positively, then you will have infinitely many hyperplanes supporting at that point. I mean, positive or negative, it doesn't matter, because if one hyperplane equation is supporting S positively, if you take minus minus, that one will support negatively. Okay. So this plus minus is actually depending on the C that you are using, that is the normal, whether you are viewing C as the positive normal or minus C as the positive normal, from which side you are viewing it. Okay. Yeah. What is a separating hyperplane? Now, separating hyperplane means if you have two sets, suppose that I have two sets somewhere here and something like this. A hyperplane that essentially keeps one set on H plus and one set inside H minus, we call positive, I mean plus, and closed half space, closed half space. So that we say that H separates H and T. Strictly separates means they will be in the, each of them will be in the open half space, strict. So here, simple separate means some of the points of T can be on H, some of the points of S can be on H, but in the strict separation, no point of S can be on H and no point of T similarly. A strong separation is between a set and a point. So if you have a set S and a point X, a strong separation would require a hyperplane that may contain some points of S, but X should be in the interior. I mean, X should be in the open half space, one of the open half space. Okay, so S may be in the closed half space, that's fine, I mean, but X should be in the open half space. So that is called strong separation. Mostly, I mean, it is easy to remember the separation and strict separation. Only you remember that strong separation is for a point, and point has to be kept in the open half. For example, in R2, okay, the hyperplane x1 equal to 0. In R2, the hyperplane x1 equal to 0. x1 equal to 0 means the y-axis. In R2, hyperplanes are, lines only. So x1 equal to 0 separates the set, this side set, the set of all x's with x coordinate negative. So that is this side. And the set of all x's with first coordinate positive. So this is your S, this is your T, and y axis. So basically y axis separates the set of points with first coordinate negative, and the other set is first coordinate positive. Okay. And if you imagine R3 there itself, you can say that the YZ axis will separate all points with first coordinate negative and all points with first coordinate positive. Okay. The plane x1 equal to 0 in R2, so that is the y axis, strictly separate. Okay. Strictly separates what? Now the points with first coordinate strictly less than minus 1. You can make a equal to also, and T, the set of points with first coordinate positive, it strictly separates. Okay, so that is strict separation. So just to say that the hyperplane does not contain any point of this, the involved sets. And the hyperplane x1 equal to 0, that is the y axis, strongly separates. This is the set with negative first coordinates. So that is the negative half plane, left half plane, And the other point should be in the interior, and that is U1. So this is what we are saying. This basically means this is the hyperplane y-axis, and this is the set S. S may be having some points. The other point is U1, which is in the other half plane. Okay, so this is about separation. This is something, some bit of thing that you about this, something that we knew. What did you know? What we knew is that if I have a compact subset, non-empty compact subset of Rn, then non-empty compact subset of Rn, a compact subset can have any kind of structure. And if you have a point X outside, okay, a compact subset, it's just a closed and bounded subset. So it can have some holes also if you want. So this is the set. Okay. Doesn't matter. But the distance function, if I take any point y over here and define fy as the distance between x and y, xy norm. Norm function is a continuous function. So this being a continuous function, you will find a point x naught somewhere here that the distance between x and that is this fy is minimized at x naught. Okay, so that we know. That is a continuous function, attains its bounds. That means a maximum, a point of maximum distance, a point of minimum distance you will find. That we know from calculus. But here we get something extra. See, for example, I give you one more this thing. Here, if we assume that this is a compact convex subset, this point x naught that you are getting, that will be unique. For example, imagine the circle, just the circle, not the interior, just the circle. Is it a closed bounded set? Now, yes, it is a closed bounded set. Then I take the point X to be the center. Then from at any point Y on the circle, this distance is minimized because everywhere it is the same distance, it is the radius only. So the convex hypothesis, without the hypothesis that it is convex, I can get more than one point. I can get many points where the minimum is attained. But here, if you assume convex, you will get that is, single point. And the this thing is, the existence that such points will exist, it comes from the compact set that we know from calculus. I will show, the proof I have given for this thing, but I will tell what is happening. Now, suppose that I have some kind of a set. I have drawn anything, but this is a closed convex set. Okay. The picture is not looking like convex. Why? Okay, let me take it so that it looks like convex. And suppose I have point X here, and I have two points somewhere, let's say X naught and X one. Suppose these are the points of minimum distance. This happens. So basically what you are looking, now you are looking a triangle kind of a structure. Okay. Then you are thinking in that case, how can this be? In that case, the middle point should be at a smaller distance from X. So basically I should be getting a contradiction, and that is easy. So what you do, you target the middle point only. Now what is, and look at the distance. Now we know that X minus X naught, that is the smallest distance. That is, so take the middle point to be Y. Okay. This is less than equal to X minus Y distance, because Y, like this is the minimum, X minus X naught was minimum. Somehow you had two points where the minimum was attained. So this is x minus y, and then x minus y is what? Now x minus y is x minus x naught by 2 plus x minus x1 by 2, that distance. But then you apply triangle inequality. Triangle inequality would say p plus q norm is less than or equal to p norm plus q norm. And what is x minus x naught by 2? Now x minus x naught was the smallest distance, and x minus x1 is also equal to x minus x naught. And so this is actually equal to x minus x naught norm, that distance. So then in that case, this inequality must be equality, because you started with x minus x naught norm, ended with x minus x naught norm. That means everywhere you should be having equality. This should be equality. This should be equality. So other equalities I am ignoring. But look at this kind of equality. When you have two vectors, u plus v, this is a this thing from linear algebra, u plus v norm, normally it is less than equal to u norm plus v norm in linear algebra. And when does the equality hold? Now the equality holds if one is a non-negative multiple of the other. Okay, that is, they lie on the same ray. Okay, starting from the origin. You start from the origin and imagine one ray, they both should be on that ray. Like many people say they lie on the same line. Actually, the same line would also not be the same, because if one is in this direction, one is in the opposite direction, then in u plus v, they will cancel each other. They will, their total norm will not be the sum of their absolute values. So they will be same non-negative multiple. So in that case, so what I see in that case, I see that because of the equality, I see that x minus x naught is a non-negative multiple x minus x1. Okay, is a non-negative multiple of x minus x1, but x minus x naught is a non-negative multiple. And I take their absolute values. If I take their absolute values, I will get the absolute values. Non-negative lambda will be there. Double nine norm. Okay. But I know that x minus x naught norm is equal to x minus x1 norm. Therefore, it follows that lambda must be equal to 1. Okay. 1 is in, I mean, they have the same distance you assumed earlier. Okay. You assumed earlier. So it follows from there that lambda is equal to 1, which basically means x minus x naught is equal to x minus x1, or x naught equal to x1. That's what it is. So proof is written over here. This is one more exercise, rather. This is very, very important. See, what it says, that if you have a convex set and x naught is a point of minimum distance, this is your x naught, and suppose this is my x. Okay, so I have a point of minimum distance. Now what you do, and take any other y in this convex set S, then you look at the angle between these two vectors. That should always be less than or equal to 90 degree. That is, you have to show that the inner product between x naught minus x and y minus x naught is always greater than equal to zero. Okay, and that is easy to show. Okay, this is not difficult to show. You can okay. Let me see something like this. What am I given? Now I am given that x and so x naught is one of the point of minimum distance and y is that. So what do I have? And I am trying to get this one. So let's see. X minus x naught norm square is less than equal to x minus y norm square, and then what I do, I write it as, that is the only thing, just give me a moment. Nandita, I am in a class now. Hello. Okay, so these are the only thing that is given to me, so I am forced to write it only this way, x minus x naught plus x naught minus y norm square. But then u plus v norm square, basically u plus v inner product u plus v, so that will be equal to x minus x naught norm square plus x naught minus y norm square plus because we are in Rn, u inner product v and v inner product u, they are symmetric, that is the same, so it is twice inner product x minus x naught minus y inner product. So what I am saying, this much is less than equal to this thing that you are seeing here. This much is less than, so you cancel this one. Okay, so what do I get? Now I get the following minus x naught minus y norm square is less than equal to twice x minus x naught minus y inner product. Okay, what is y? Now y was some point given. So some any point over S. Well, if that is the case, I would also, I can give more y's. For example, if you have given me x naught in a convex set and you have given me y also in a convex set, I can take a y lambda, for example, over here. Now, what is y lambda? Now, y lambda I will put, it will also be true for y lambda, which is x naught plus lambda time, lambda between 0 and 1, the vector starting from x naught to y, that is y minus x naught. So this equation will also be true for y lambda. Okay, now I substitute y lambda. If I substitute y lambda, then what will you get? Now x naught minus y lambda, if you take x naught minus y lambda, then what you will get? Now you will get minus, I mean lambda y minus x naught norm square. So you will be getting a minus over here, lambda square here, and y minus x naught norm square. Okay, and what will you get over here? Now 2 will remain as such, x minus x naught will remain as such, and x naught minus y, Now x naught minus y, where is this? And instead of y, I am taking y lambda. So I will be having minus lambda y minus x naught. This inner product. Okay. Now lambda is a positive number between 0 and 1. So lambda you cancel. So then the square coach. Fine. And instead of, so x minus, here y minus x naught that I have. Wait a minute. That is fine. And what do I get? So what you do, instead of y minus x naught, I am keeping as it is. I don't change. There is a minus sign I have, but here I have written x minus x naught. So I will write this as equal to 2 x naught minus x and y minus x naught. And so that is always greater than equal to minus of lambda times y minus x naught whole square. Y is fixed, but lambda can be between 0 and 1. So taking limit lambda going to 0, what do you see? That this object is greater than equal to 0. This is a fixed one. This is fixed because x is fixed, x naught is fixed, y is fixed, x naught is fixed, everything is fixed. That fixed thing is greater than equal to some lambda times something. Okay. So when lambda goes to 0, that will go to 0. So that proves that this is greater than equal to 0. That basically means what we wanted to show. And then you can use this to prove the uniqueness in x naught. So that's the thing. Strict separation. Well, you can easily prove the same thing. So you have x over here, x naught over here. Since x is outside and this is a closed convex set. Acha, by the way, if s is, this S is closed convex. If S is closed and X is outside, okay, X is outside S, then this point of minimum distance, whatever you will get, it will be a point different from X. I mean, the distance will be some positive number. It cannot be zero. Zero means X will belong to S, okay, because S is closed. So therefore, distance will be something positive. So this segment that you are seeing between x to x naught, that is a non-trivial line segment. You will have, I mean, some length. So then you will have a middle point, and then you, what you do, now you take c, that is equal to, what is the c? Now c is this line segment. What is c? Is the vector, non-zero vector, x naught minus x. That is fine. That you can take C. If you want to normalize, you take C, like divide it by its norm. That will be the normalized vector in this direction. And let it pass through the middle point. So what do you do? Now, whatever is the middle point, so you take alpha equal to this C transpose M. Whatever is that value, you call that. And take H is equal to the set of all Z so that C transpose Z equal to alpha. Okay, so this is the hyperplane. So that will be the hyperplane that passes through the middle point. Okay, and what do you have? Now you have C transpose C. C transpose C is always C norm square, right? And that is always strictly bigger than 0. 1 minute.
Hello. Nandita, I am inside a class. I will call you after some time. Everything is fine with me, okay? Fine.
Yeah, so this is always, since C is a non-trivial vector, this is strictly bigger than 0. But then what is it? Now this is, you remember C is equal to x naught minus x. So it is like C transpose x naught minus x is strictly bigger than 0. It basically means C transpose x naught is strictly bigger than C transpose C transpose C is strictly bigger than C transpose C transpose X naught is strictly bigger than C transpose X plus X naught by 2 M. So this basically means I want to show that C transpose X naught by 2 is greater than C transpose X by 2. And yeah, that was coming from here. That was C transpose X naught is strictly bigger than C transpose X. So by 2 you do, so you get this. Yeah, this was correct. It was coming from there. So it basically means this side would be H plus. This side would be H plus. And this side would be H minus. And in fact, for every point over here, you can show that that satisfies C transpose Y greater than or equal to alpha. So anyway, so this is a strict separation. So what is it saying? Now, if you have a closed convex set S and a point outside, you know how to find a hyperplane. You can find many. In fact, this need not have to pass through the middle point. You can get it passed through this, or you can get it passed through this. It's like from any point. So strictly separates X and S. Actually, this is probably a wrong use, but it is okay. This is actually strong separation of X and S. I mean, if you really want to use that language, but this is understandable. If I am saying strictly separates X and X, it means that I am viewing X as a singleton set and viewing them as two sets. So that is fine, no problem. And here it is strictly separation. Actually, it is not strong separation, because in strong separation, I am allowing one set to be in the closed half. Right now, I am talking about strict, both of them to be interior. So it is strictly is correct use. Okay. So here it comes, the strong separation by a supporting hyperplane. That is the same thing, very, very easy. As I said, if you have the set S over here and you have X, given a point X outside, you will have a point of minimum distance X naught. And then you can take your hyperplane, make your hyperplane pass through X naught. And so that will be a supporting hyperplane, keeping the whole set on the positive half space. So that is possible. And the argument is very similar as I did there. So that is fine. And here is the lemma 4.11. What it says, that every supporting hyperplane to a non-empty closed convex cone is linear. That is, the alpha will be zero. This part is very easy, because, I mean, if the alpha is positive, then you can think about, and the set will be on one half space, because it is a cone, zero will be there. Therefore, you will have the value that either, depending on what you have assumed, you will have either alpha greater than zero or greater than equal to zero, or alpha less than equal to zero. And for any other point where this is easy, actually, two line here, you people do. Yeah, like there are some more things I have to do. So let me, I mean, it is, time is running away. So let me do and that part you do. Okay, here are some properties of convex sets. The first one says the following. This is required to tell this one, second one. So suppose that, let me tell it in R2, okay. In R2, what you do, you look at point E1, E2, minus E1, minus E2. And what you do, you look at one, take epsilon less than 1 by n square. 1 by n square, n is 2, so this is 1 by 4 ball. You look at disks of length, radius 1 by 4. Here. And choose any point of your choice here. Any point as you like. And take their convex hull. Depending on whatever points you have taken, take their convex hull. That convex hull will contain the origin as an interior point. That's what it says. Then 0 is an interior point of the convex hull of xn, yn, x1 to xn. X1 is this one, x2 is this one. This one is called y1, this one is called y2. Okay, so that's what it says. It will always contain, and you can use that to show that whenever you have a convex set, suppose that you have a convex set in some R5 or R10, you have a convex set. Yes. Okay, some kind of an abstract convex set. Yes, something. And convex set need not be closed or open. You can have some part of the boundary, some points, like nothing. But you look at S closure. Okay. When you look at S closure, and suppose that S closure contains some B epsilon Y. That means a ball of radius epsilon centered at Y is in here, in the S closure, the bigger set. Now the question is it necessary that this B epsilon Y will be in S? Now, if S is convex given, the answer is yes. If S is not convex given, you cannot say. For example, even in one dimension, either you take one dimension or you two dimension. So suppose let me take S equal to Q square, Q cross Q, Q square. Okay. And then what is S closure? Now S closure will be R square. R square contains B1 0. Does Q square contain B1 0? No, it does not. But if S is convex, you can say this. So that's what point 2 says. And point 2 second part says, therefore, it is the converse kind of a thing. If A is a boundary point of S and S is convex, then A is a boundary point of S closure. That's what it says. Okay. This is boundary. Delta S. Delta S means S closure intersection S complement closure. Okay, that's the boundary. Okay. And a third one is another property, but I am not going to use that. This I am going to use to show the existence of a supporting hyperplane at any boundary point. You would say, wait. You just talked about some supporting hyperplane at some point, nah? Yes, I did. There, what I did is the following. There, the set was given to me, convex set, okay? And a point was given to me. And then, because this point X was given to me, there, I said that there will exist a unique point of minimum distance X naught. and I will have a supporting hyperplane there. But this x naught, I did not have any choice. It existed on its own. But here, what is the case? Now here is the case. The set S convex set is given, and some arbitrary boundary points is given to me from the beginning. Now how do I get a supporting hyperplane passing through Y? If I have to use the previous theorem, then I will have to search for some X for which this Y will be the point of minimum distance. Ye to mushkil hai. Okay. So that is why the argument is something different. Now what you do, now you, this is a boundary point of S. Now a boundary point of S will be a boundary point of S closure. That's what you said. If S is convex, then a boundary point of S is also a boundary point of S closure. So in view of that, I can simply imagine S to be closed itself. And in that case, let me approach it by a sequence. So what will I do? Now I will have a sequence yn of points approaching to yn from outside. These are coming from, since S is closed, these are coming from S complement. Okay, right now I am assuming S is closed because of that. Now for each yn you will get a yn dax, that is the point of minimum distance. So for each yn you will get a point of minimum distance. Okay, and then as yn goes to y, you will see that yn minus yn dax, this norm is less than equal to yn minus y, because yn dax is the point of minimum distance from yn, and y is just any point. Okay, and since this goes to zero, they all of them will go to the same limit. Okay, wherever yn will go, yn dax will go, so yn dax also converges to y. That is fine. Now what you do, now we consider this cn is equal to yn dax minus yn. Okay, remember S is closed, yn outside, therefore this vector is of non-zero length. You normalize that so that cn is a vector that has norm 1, and I already know I can imagine a hyperplane that keeps the set on the positive half. I already know all you have to do, make it pass through the middle point, or even make it pass through yn dax. That is also fine. Okay, but then what is the trick? Now see, look, this is unit vector. So unit vector in where? Now this is a unit vector in Rn. Okay, so then this cn, this c1 c2 cn, this set c1 c2 this, okay, this is, so that this is a sequence of points in where? Now in the closed unit sphere. Okay, the closed unit sphere in Rn, which is closed and bounded. Okay, that is compact. Therefore this sequence will have a convergent subsequence. So suppose cnk is the convergent subsequence, converges to C. Okay, then from the beginning itself I could have considered ynk, and like ynk I would have called zk, and starting that zk converges to y. So in view of this, let me simply say cn goes to C. Okay, so rather than like just to avoid this subscript, once you have a sequence, I could have started with that sequence of ynk. So in that case, the sequence YNK goes and the corresponding CNK also goes to C. So in view of that, let me say CN goes to C. And since CN goes to C, each CN has norm 1, it follows that C will have norm 1. And not only that, since each of this HN was what? Now CN transpose Z equal to alpha N. Alpha N, what did you fix? Do you want it to be passing through the midpoint or do you want to be passing through YN dax? Anything that you want. Suppose you want it to be passing through this, then alpha N, you should be taking CN transpose multiplied with YN plus YN dax divided by 2. That is the middle point, the middle point of YN and YN dax. Okay. And this one contains the set S inside HN plus, as we have shown. So each of them, okay, remember YN and YN dax, as I said, both of them are going to Y. Okay, that's what we showed over here. Okay, showed over here. Both of them are going to Y. CN is going to C. Okay, so ultimately, what am I getting? Now I am getting H, that is C transpose Z equal to C transpose Y. This is the alpha. Okay, so this is the hyperplane ultimately that I am getting, C transpose Z equal to alpha. Since each of the HN, the hyperplane, sequence of hyperplanes, they were keeping the whole set on the positive half space, the resulting, this one will also contain it in the positive half space. And what is this? Is this a supporting hyperplane? Now, yes, it is a supporting hyperplane to what? To S. At what? Now at Y. Look, C transpose Z equal to alpha. If you put Z equal to Y, it will satisfy. So that is how you get a supporting hyperplane at any arbitrary point. Okay. And what is this? So what will you do with this supporting hyperplane, existence of supporting hyperplane at any arbitrary point? Now, well, this is the benefit. What is the benefit? Now, look, if you have a, suppose, okay, so here is what I am saying. Suppose you have a set S. Imagine the closed solid table, the table that you are studying, you imagine it to be a solid parallel, solid cube or something, cuboid. Okay, you solid that one. Imagine that. So that, as an example, so I have a convex set. Okay, S. Suppose that I have a boundary point X in del S. What do you imagine? Now you imagine the tabletop and look at the center. That is your X. That's a boundary point. Fine. Then this theorem says there is a hyperplane supporting S, supporting hyperplane at X. So for you, it will be the plane of that tabletop. The tabletop plane will be the plane that will be going through the center. Okay, so there exists H. It is a supporting hyperplane. Okay, so for you, it is the tabletop. Fine. Then it says, you look at H intersection S. So if you are looking at H intersection S, you are getting that surface of the top surface of the table. That is a subset of S. Okay, the whole table is solid table is S, so tabletop. Okay, and off the tabletop, you pick a vertex. pick a vertex of H intersection S. So imagine one tabletop corner W. Then this lemma says, then W will also be a vertex of the table. So it basically says a vertex of the table top is a vertex of the table. That's what it says. Okay. So why it is so beautiful? Now somebody says, okay, you look at the solid table and go and find the vertices. Now what do you do? Now one technique is just pick one boundary point, take a supporting hyperplane. So now this is a subset, and of that you try to find the vertices. How do you find vertices? Now you just look at that tabletop. This is a closed convex set. Now take a boundary point. The tabletop is in R2. Take a boundary point. So boundary point will be on the edge. Take a hyperplane. So you will take hyperplane, that is the line. So you will get one edge, and that will give you two vertices. Okay. So basically you can apply this recursively to get your W's. So that is how you will get it. For example, it says if you are looking at the circular disk, then it says circular disk, that is S. Any point at the boundary is a vertex. Now this is the point on the boundary, and then you look at the hyperplane that passes through that. Okay, that will be the tangent. If you are looking at the circle in R2, then you will have the tangent line. Otherwise, in other dimension, you will have a tangent space itself. Okay, no problem. In R3, you will have a tangent plane. No problem. But nevertheless, H intersection S will only be that point. If that point is V, it will only be that singleton point V. There will be no other point. And this is a convex set, and V itself is a vertex. So therefore, it says of every sphere, okay, of the circle, every point on the boundary of the circle, circular disk, is a vertex. Okay, so that's what it says. I won't have time to cover 4.16 onwards. So I will do that later in the next class. Okay. You want to ask any question?